There are over 4,000 empty lots in North Omaha, many in the predominantly black section of town. The houses that once stood here disappeared for a number of reasons. Some were taken for the North Freeway, a process that's been going on for more than a quarter of a century. Many others were eventually raised after years of neglect by absentee landlords. The house located on this lot met with demolition of a different sort. On August 17, 1970, 2867 Ohio Street was destroyed by a dynamite blast that left one police officer dead and several others badly injured. The dead officer was Larry D. Menard. He and the other police had been lured into the house to find a booby-trapped bomb. After the incident, a manhunt of tremendous magnitude began. Over 1,000 people were arrested or questioned. Eventually, two men were tried for the crime. For a time, their names became household words: David Rice and Edward Poindexter. They were both found guilty and in April of 1971 were sentenced to life in prison. Since that time, David Rice has carried out an ongoing appeal, an appeal whose chapters read like a mystery, each page revealing a new piece of a complicated puzzle. Join us as we review the intriguing and controversial case of Rice and Poindexter. Considering the number of appeals that David Rice has filed over the past 12 years, this case has been, in Rice's own words, like a roller coaster ride. But before we introduce you to the ups and downs and the pieces of the puzzle, we must remember the temper of the times. Here in Omaha, relations between the black community and police were probably at their worst during the late 60s and early 70s. It was in the late 60s that the NCCF, the National Committee to Combat Fascism, was formed. Among other things, the organization monitored police actions in the black community. Members were highly critical of police and often made strong statements about their use of force. It was the constant tension between these groups that culminated in acts of violence and confrontation on both sides. Two of the main leaders of the NCCF were David Rice and Edward Poindexter. It was not the best of times.
There was a tremendous amount of police activity in what we commonly refer to as the ghetto. It was commonly referred to as the Near North Side. It was the area of Omaha north of Cumming Street, east of 16th Street, west of 16th Street, and east of 40th Street, and as far north as blacks lived.
Omaha attorney David Herzog represented David Rice from 1970 to about 1975.
In the middle and late 60s, the assassination of President Kennedy, the murder of his brother Bobby, the murder of Martin Luther King, all of those produced a condition of tension that was unbelievable in the Omaha community. Large numbers of UNO students were actively involved in anti-Vietnam War activities. Large numbers of whites, particularly Catholics and some Jews, were involved in a concerted effort to end the war in Vietnam. There was a tremendous amount of social consciousness of what was wrong with living in the United States in the political climate that was in existence in the middle and late 60s. You had an awareness of police officers being in the ghetto to such degree that some black zealot, some black civil rights activists were accusing police officers of being occupation troops. The civilian occupation troops of a segment of the community in which blacks resided.
There was a belief that the NCCF was a radical black organization, that they were patterned after the National Black Panther Party. Some, especially law enforcement agencies here in Omaha, believed that the NCCF was an actual Panther branch. It was a belief that David Herzog says was unfounded and untrue.
It's my belief and understanding that the NCCF was found to be unacceptable by Huey Newton and by some of the other more well-known, nationally known figures of the Black Panther Party. But I think that the police in Omaha at that time believed that the NCCF in Omaha were disciples of the Black Panther Party of California, and that was not true. The objectives of the NCCF were salutary. They operated a food service to the poor. They taught classes in political awareness of what was wrong with police actions in the ghetto. They taught matters or subjects of self-defense. They taught subjects of personal hygiene. They taught reading courses.
The most damaging evidence presented by the prosecution was the testimony of this man, Dwayne Christopher Peek. Peek testified at trial that Rice, Poindexter, and he each had a role in the placement of the bomb at 2867 Ohio Street that night. He testified that Poindexter made the bomb, that Rice stored the dynamite used in the bomb, and that he delivered it. Dwayne was a member of the NCCF for a while, but according to David Rice, was let go because of his, quote, drug problem, unquote, and was not a member of the NCCF at the time of the bombing. Peek, on the other hand, said he was a member and that he, Rice, and Poindexter had conspired to, quote, blow up some pigs, unquote. But this, like other parts of Peek's testimony, changed many times during his original statement to police and his testimony at the trial itself. The most glaring inconsistencies took place during the preliminary hearing. Rice and Poindexter remember vividly that hearing.
In the morning session, Dwayne Peek was called upon to testify by the state of Nebraska. My attorney, Ed Poindexter's attorney, objected, asked for a recess on the basis that Dwayne, since he was facing charges as well, did not have the benefit of the presence of his attorney. We simply wanted a recess until such time his attorney could be there. The motion was denied. Judge said that, Judge Simon said, Dwayne, go ahead and testify.
And then he took the stand and said, in essence, no, you know, they didn't have anything to do with this, you know, I did it on my own, you know. And apparently that shocked the prosecution.
They asked for a recess, just as we had. It was granted, just like that. Dwayne Peek came back that afternoon, was asked the same questions, answered yes. When he came back in the afternoon, he was wearing sunglasses. He had not worn them that morning. He was obviously nervous, he was shaking. My attorney asked him under cross-examination, he said, Dwayne, are you scared? Dwayne said, yes. He said, are you afraid of David Rice or Ed Poindexter? He said, no. He said, who are you afraid of? He said, the police. He asked him then something to the effect, are you saying then that what you're telling us now is what the police want you to do? Dwayne Peek said, yes. The preliminary hearing should have ended then.
We talked to several people in attendance at that preliminary hearing. They noted that defense attorney David Herzog asked Peek later in that hearing to take off his sunglasses. Upon doing so, they say an audible gasp went through the courtroom. The reason for that response, they say, was Peek's eyes. They told us that Peek's eyes were swollen and red. They say it was obvious that Duane had been crying. David Herzog's cross-examination of Peek during the trial revealed other inconsistencies between Peek's trial testimony and earlier statements. For instance, when Peek was first arrested, he told police in a statement that he received an anonymous note from a woman telling him to go to Lothrop Drugstore. There he was to pick up a suitcase and wait for a phone call that would give him further instructions. Peek was called, according to his statement, and told to leave the suitcase in an alley near 28th and Ohio Streets. Later, he was to call 911, the emergency police number, and tell police to come to a house at 2866 or 2867 Ohio, that a man had dragged a woman into the house and was beating her up. He was then to erase any knowledge of the suitcase. In this statement, Peek claimed that he didn't know a bomb was in the suitcase. He thought it contained important papers that had to be delivered. In yet another statement to police, Peek claimed that he made the bomb himself, put the bomb in the house at 2867 Ohio, called the police to the house, and armed the bomb so that it would be ready to explode. There was never any mention of Rice or Poindexter in either of these statements. Later, in the afternoon session of the preliminary hearing and in a pretrial deposition, Peek claims that he went to Rice's house where he says the dynamite was stored. He said Poindexter got the dynamite from the basement, made the bomb, gave him instructions on arming the bomb, and told him where to place it. Peek was later instructed to make the phone call to the police.
Did you ever believe that, based on what some would consider to be the shakiness of the prosecution star witness and all of the other, I guess, what some people would call circumstantial evidence, did you ever think that you would be in jail for 12 years?
Well, at the time, you know, we looked at it from two perspectives, you know, from a strictly legal perspective, you know, and as we were going through the trial, it looked good, you know, and but in the back of my head, you know, I realized that a trial was highly political, and that here we were out in the community being highly critical of the judicial system and the government, and now we're caught up in that process, you know. And so I felt that, you know, given the highly political nature of the case, it was quite possible that regardless of what kind of evidence was produced or wasn't produced or was substantiated or was not substantiated, we could still get convicted.
All of these statements surfaced during the trial, and Peek admitted that he did tell all of them to police officers at one time or another. He said, however, that the story that implicated Rice and Poindexter was the correct story. Obviously, Duane Peek was a critical element to the prosecution's case, and some speculated that a deal had been made. After all, Peek had also been charged with first-degree murder. He might have been promised leniency if he would testify against Rice and Poindexter. The prosecution vehemently denied that a deal had been made. On page 490 of the trial transcript, prosecution attorney Arthur O'Leary attempted to back up their denial of a deal by asking Duane Peek, question, Duane, have you been promised anything in return for your testimony? Duane's answer, no, I haven't. O'Leary's question, by anyone? Peek's answer, no. But later in the trial transcript, on page 528, defense attorney David Herzog asks, question, has your attorney ever told you if you testify against Edward Poindexter and David Rice that you might be allowed to plead to a lesser crime? Peek's answer, he said there was a possibility, yes. Herzog's question, he said there was a possibility? Peek's answer, yes. On May 3rd, 1971, almost 2 weeks after Duane Peek testified against Rice and Poindexter, the charge of first-degree murder against him was dropped in juvenile court. Peek was found guilty of juvenile delinquency and sentenced to 1 year in the boys' reformatory in Kearney, Nebraska. Of that 1 year, Peek stayed exactly 12 days. He then went on extended furlough and has not been seen since. The county attorney, the FBI, and the local Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms, all involved in the Rice Poindexter case, claim they have no knowledge of Peek's whereabouts. While Duane Peek provided the most damaging evidence to Rice and Poindexter, it wasn't the only evidence. Acting on a tip, police searched the home of David Rice, where they say a box of dynamite, like that used in the Menard slang, was found in Rice's basement. That dynamite served as the death blow for the defense. But the way that evidence was obtained would serve to be its salvation in later appeals. Almost.
The evidence that was obtained and used against David Rice was wrongfully, illegally, and unacceptably obtained. And Judge Warren Erbaum's decision that was ultimately appealed to the United States Supreme Court has never been argued with regard to its holding that the evidence that was used against David Rice was illegally, wrongfully, and improperly obtained, illegally, wrongfully, and improperly used in the court trial in the district court in Omaha.
Warren Erbaum is a federal district court judge for the state of Nebraska. His decision to overturn the lower courts came on July 5, 1974. Erbaum ruled that the search warrants used to enter Rice's home were invalid and the search illegal based on the Fourth Amendment to the United States Constitution.
Judge Erbaum has been upheld by the United States Court of Appeals in St. Louis two times. After the first appearance before Judge Erbaum and his subsequent rulings finding the search warrant invalid, the state of Nebraska appealed to the Court of Appeals. A panel of three judges in St. Louis found that the search warrant was invalid and agreed with Judge Erbaum's analysis. The Attorney General asked for a rehearing before the entire Court of Appeals, all the judges of the Court of Appeals, and the entire group of judges of the United States Court of Appeals for the Eighth Circuit found that Judge Erbaum was correct in his analysis of the law of search and seizure.
While Erbaum's decision itself was not questioned by the Supreme Court, what was at issue was the procedure for hearing Fourth Amendment cases.
In essence, what happened was the United States Supreme Court said, we don't care what issue was presented to the federal court, we're slamming the door on all prisoners who resort to federal court for relief if they've had a fair opportunity, not a perfect opportunity, not a good opportunity, not a three-quarters opportunity, not a half opportunity. They've had any opportunity to fairly present their arguments to the state court, which gets back to the old doctrine in the pre-1960s of states' rights.
They didn't even define in David's case what an opportunity for a full and fair hearing is.
Father William Cunningham is David Rice's attorney now, and he has been since early 1975.
What I'm saying is that without defining what an opportunity for a full and fair hearing, is it a full and fair hearing, for example, Ben, if the Supreme Court of the state of Nebraska so grossly and egregiously misapplies Supreme Court of the United States opinions that two federal courts that look at it and the Supreme Court that looks at it said, you're absolutely wrong. Is that a fair hearing? I don't think so. So I don't think David even had that. It was a procedural flim-flam to cut down habeas corpus jurisdiction in federal courts. And it was more of the Supreme Court's leaning toward states' rights. So that if, you know, and I'm told that the quality of the Supreme Court in the state of Nebraska has improved, God, I hope so. Because in 1972, when they made that decision in State versus Rice and Poindexter, it was pathetic.
Both Cunningham and Herzog were surprised and disappointed at the U.S. Supreme Court's decision. It was a decision that practically snuffed out the hopes of Rice and Poindexter of being free men anytime soon, if ever.
After the landmark decision by the U.S. Supreme Court in 1976, Father Cunningham sought a new appeal for David Rice. In this latest appeal, now on file with the Nebraska State Supreme Court, the defense wanted to show that Rice didn't have a fair trial in 71 because the county attorney's office suppressed evidence. That evidence, claims Cunningham, may have been an important and deciding factor when the jury reached its decision. To obtain new ammunition for the defense, Cunningham utilized the Freedom of Information Act to try and force federal agencies to turn over all evidence in the Rice-Poindexter case. The agencies were extremely slow in responding. However, in 1980, the defense subpoenaed and eventually did receive three pieces of evidence, two of which this latest appeal is based. On April 29, 1980, the Dodge County Jail in Fremont, Nebraska, furnished Cunningham with a copy of this letter. Dodge County Jail is where Duane Peek was held during the preliminary hearing and the Rice Poindexter trial. The letter was sent by Duane Peek to Olivia Norris after the preliminary hearing. Olivia was close to Peek, so close he called her mom. The letter reads in part, "What's happening, moms? I got your letter today. It was real inspiring to hear from you, especially at a time like this. They had me in court today. I guess you already know that by now. The Lord knows I tried, but something happened which forced me to realize that I had no alternative but to say what I said. No matter what anybody says from now on, I refuse to call myself a man or anything close to a man because I did what I did. Even though there was no other way, because they already had enough evidence to convict these other two bloods, I don't know. Maybe I sound kind of nutty, but that's just the way I feel. Or maybe I'm just trying to get somebody to say that what I did was justifiable, but I know it can't be justified. I not only turned against those two bloods, but I turned against myself and my own people. I could have denied everything, and all three of us would have gone up to the chair. And then again, if I denied everything, one of those other bloods would have gave them a story and sent me another dude up. But neither one of those is the reason. I was scared a little, but that's not the reason. I guess I'll never know. Now I have to wait until my actual trial before I find out whether I get the chair or life." Cunningham contends that this letter would have been strong ammunition for the defense during the trial. He says that, first of all, the letter would have cast a doubt about the state of mind of Peek in the jury's eyes. Cunningham states that there were also statements in the letter that could have been questioned at length. For example, when Peek said, quote, "But something happened which forced me to realize that I had no alternative but to say what I said," unquote, what was he actually talking about? What happened? And when Peek said, quote, "If I deny everything, one of those other bloods would have gave them a story and sent me and the other dude up," unquote, who was the other dude? Was it Rice or Poindexter, or was it somebody else?
Defense attorneys during the original trial had no knowledge of that letter or its contents. But Cunningham claims in his latest appeal before the Nebraska State Supreme Court that the county attorney's office did know about that letter and should have turned it over to defense attorneys. Cunningham says, in fact, the county attorney's office tried to introduce another letter that was more favorable to its side during the trial, but that was denied by the judge. Cunningham contends that it was improbable for the county attorney's office to know about one letter and not know about the other. But even if that was the case,
we have a case called Giglio versus the United States. That case stands for the proposition that what one does minds all of them. And if that be an administrative burden, so be it. Solve it. So that doctrine then has extended not just for the county attorney's office, but for the state, because the prosecution is in the name of the state. You can't have the county attorney, his assistants, several of them, one a special prosecutor, Arthur O'Leary, who's kept on for the purpose just of prosecuting that case, Lieutenant Perry, Lieutenant Pfeffer, Sergeant Swanson, all of the people working in different capacities on that case, rattling around like unleashed cannons and saying, well, what they do is their business. No, it isn't. It's the state who brought the prosecution. They're agents and engines of the prosecution for the state, and what the state does is done by all of them. So, they sink together or they swim together.
The county attorney's office refused comment on the letter. Their reason for refusal, the case is still in court. The second piece of evidence that has caused considerable controversy is an audio tape furnished by the county attorney's office to Father Cunningham. That tape is a copy of a call that was made to 911 on August 17, 1970, the call that eventually ended in the death of police officer Larry Menard.
Well, I've lost a check announcer.
16-year-old Dwayne Peek said he was the one who made that phone call to police. The call came in a little after 2 a.m. on August 17th. Once again, at a slightly different tape speed, the call to 911.
Was never given to the defendants at the trial, prior to the trial, or to their lawyers. Never having heard Dwayne Peek's voice, I took it immediately to David Herzog, David's lawyer, at the time of the trial. And David Herzog told me, as he told Sam Cooper that same day, when Sam Cooper played it for him for the first time, that's not the voice of Dwayne Peek.
I sat in hours upon hours of depositions with Dwayne Christopher Peek. I talked to him while the court reporter recorded his responses to my questions, to Governor Morrison's questions, and to Mr. Thomas Kinney's questions. But his opportunity for knowing the events and circumstances that he testified or was going to testify about, and trying to probe how a young man of 15 years old could come up with seven or eight different stories about how he carried a suitcase full of dynamite all over North Omaha. We were able, through this pretrial discovery procedure, the depositions, to be in close physical proximity to Dwayne Peek and to talk to him and to hear his voice for hours.
If that be so, he perjured himself three times under oath, Dwayne Peek, that he was the maker of that call.
We talked briefly with Douglas County Attorney Donald Knowles by phone about the 911 tape and why it had not been introduced at the original trial. Knowles claims that when his office took a deposition or statement from Dwayne Peek, they played the tape for Peek and asked if it was his voice. According to Knowles, Peek said that it was indeed his voice. Knowles said that based on that, there was no need to go any further. Knowles claims that at no time did the state try to hide the tape from defense attorneys at the original trial, and he doesn't know why the defense attorneys didn't know about that tape. We asked Knowles if he, at some point during the trial, told Rice and Poindexter's attorneys about the tape. His response was, quote, "I don't remember, and even if I didn't, it wasn't necessary," unquote. Probably the most encouraging evidence that defense attorneys have obtained to date came in the form of this memo, released by the FBI. The memo was written by the special agent in charge here in Omaha, which is what the initials SAC mean. It was written to the director of the FBI, who was at that time J. Edgar Hoover. The memo reads in part, "In a preliminary hearing held 9/28/70 in Municipal Court, Omaha, Peek testified that he had made the telephone call to the Omaha PD telling them that a woman was screaming in a house at 2867 Ohio Street. Police officer Larry Menard was subsequently killed when a booby-trapped suitcase exploded as he and other officers answered this call. Somebody, and the name is blotted out in the Omaha PD, advised that he feels that any use of the tapes of this call might be prejudicial to the police murder trial against two accomplices of Peek. Therefore, he advises that he wishes no use of this tape until after the murder trials of Peek and the two accomplices has been completed. No further efforts are being made at this time to secure additional tape recordings of the original telephone call." When this memo was released to Cunningham and David Rice through the Freedom of Information Act, the name of the police officer who wished no use of the tape in the 1971 trial was blotted out, and so were a few other things, including the word tape, shown here. But the word was inadvertently not blacked out when Edward Poindexter asked for his records under the Freedom of Information Act as well. So we have no way of telling you who the officer was or what some of the other information says. But the memo is clear. Someone in the Omaha Police Division felt that FBI use of the tape would damage the prosecution of Rice and Poindexter.
The thing is, we don't know whether it's Duane B's voice or not. But the point is that somebody in the Omaha Police Department, and by implication, somebody in the county attorney's office, because we have to assume that they worked together on the case, either knew it was not Duane Peake's voice or believed that it wasn't. And whichever is the case, they withheld evidence that would have had an important impact on the case. So we're not just talking about some technical matters of law, like, you know, people say, oh, it's just a constitutional violation. We're not talking about that. We're talking about agencies manipulating and manufacturing and so forth.
All of this new evidence, the letter, the tape, and the FBI memo, was introduced in what is called a post-conviction evidentiary hearing in Douglas County District Court during 1980 and 1981. Judge Paul Hickman was the presiding judge. During the hearing, several interesting incidents took place. In one instance, defense attorneys asked for certain records from the county attorney's office. The county attorney, Donald Knowles, said that many of the items that defense attorney Bill Cunningham said he wanted were not present. He refused to say they were lost, he just couldn't find them. Knowles went on to say, quote, I don't know my obligation to keep records to start with, unquote. Another event distressed Cunningham even more. It concerned some blasting caps that were introduced as evidence against Rice and Poindexter during the original trial.
The state had some blasting caps that they claim had been taken out of my house. I deny it, but the point is they claim that they took them out of my house and that they were in possession of them. At some point, during the course of the hearing, in our request for different kinds of evidence, they said that that the blasting caps had been destroyed, that they had gotten a court order to destroy the caps, and allegedly the reason was that they were dangerous hanging around wherever they were, or lying around wherever they were. So they got the court order to destroy them, and so they destroyed them. So we complained.
First of all, the order was sought in secret, granted in secret, absolutely wrong. And I moved in June of 1980 to immediately release David because evidence that would be necessary for the retrial, which was the subject of the motion to vacate and set aside the judgment, had been destroyed secretly. And faced with that prospect,
lo and behold, within a matter of weeks, I believe, they say, you know what? We didn't destroy all of them. We only destroyed about half of them. I believe they said there were four and they destroyed two. Well, they were ordered by the court, you know, on the basis of an order that they sought themselves to destroy the things. But no, it just so happened we did not destroy two of them. So not only did they destroy evidence, but they disobeyed the mandate of the court.
The hearing was concluded in April 1981. Judge Hickman's decision was released in January of 1982. In that judgment, Hickman refused to admit the FBI memo as evidence, saying he couldn't be sure of its authenticity, and it also contained hearsay evidence in his judgment. The judge also said that there was not enough evidence to show that the 911 tape in and of itself created enough of a reasonable doubt about the defendant's guilt. Hickman also stated that though David Herzog is a credible witness, it had been almost 9 years since he last heard Duane Peake's voice, and that Herzog's recollection might be questionable. About the Olivia Norris letter, Judge Hickman said that the letter merely shows Peake's remorse at having to implicate Rice and Poindexter in the Menard slaying. In addition, Hickman asserted that he could find no evidence that a deal had been made by the county attorney or anyone else with Duane Peake to get him to testify against Rice and Poindexter. At present, Hickman's decision is being appealed to the Nebraska State Supreme Court. From the beginning, the Rice-Poindexter case was, for the most part, handled at the local level. But was there some federal involvement in the case? Local officials claimed that federal involvement was only superficial. However, supporters of Rice and Poindexter think that the federal role was greater than that. In the late 60s and early 70s, the FBI operated what a House Subcommittee on Intelligence called an unusual spy program against citizens in this country. It was to be learned later that thousands of illegal wiretaps were used to spy on people who did nothing more than protest the war in Vietnam or blacks who wanted to end discriminatory practices in this country. The operation was codenamed COINTELPRO, which meant nothing more than counterintelligence program. The program was instituted by J. Edgar Hoover, then director of the FBI. In fact, most of the operation was supervised by Hoover himself. Hoover's program was literally designed to search out and find ways to neutralize people whom he considered to be enemies of this country. Those enemies included the Ku Klux Klan, the Nazi Party, several Jewish groups, and the Black Panther Party, just to mention a few. Methods were devised to either embarrass the leaders of these groups or find ways to eliminate them by charging them with a crime and having them sent to prison.
You know, that type of thing went on all across the country. You know, we got, there's still brothers and sisters, man, that are still doing time in prisons all across this country. We're involved in basically the same type of COINTEL operation and frame up that David and myself were victims of. And countless others, you know, driven underground, you know, left the country and killed, you know, basically victims of the same operation.
The man Hoover considered to be one of the worst enemies of this country was Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr. King was a sworn enemy of Hoover's, and it was learned later that King was the subject of one of the most intensive slander campaigns the FBI, and specifically J. Edgar Hoover, could muster. At one point, it was alleged the FBI leaked information that King had a very active and perverted sex life, and that there were tapes available to prove it. One of those tapes was eventually sent anonymously to Coretta Scott King, Dr. King's wife. This was just one of many ways in which the FBI tried to silence King. While King was one focal point of the COINTELPRO operation, he was by no means the only target. It was learned in later years that the FBI had established a list of people that were considered threats to the security of this country. The names included such people as actress Jane Fonda, seen here in a recent visit to Omaha, and actor Robert Redford, shown here in the movie The Electric Horseman. On the local level, one of those most affected by the constant FBI surveillance under this operation was State Senator Ernest Chambers.
They watched me for over a dozen years. They put me on what they call a rabble-rouser file. They had followed me or had informers whenever I went to give a speech in another city. They had copies of newspaper articles, letters that I'd written to various officials, requests that I'd made for investigations into police misconduct in Omaha. But their final conclusion was that in all those years, they could not develop anything of a derogatory nature on me. They had talked to former employees at the post office, people who were in the Army Reserves with me, my neighbors, everybody. So I think it was a great waste of time and money, but they had in mind to try to catch somebody that they thought ought to be locked away. And what they wanted me for was my mind. I was saying the kind of things and trying to do the things to fight racism that the FBI did not like. So they put forth all that time and money to try to get me, and there's nothing I've ever done that was in violation of the law.
When you got your records under the Freedom of Information Act from the FBI, what kinds of things were in there?
They had some of the things that I've mentioned to you, but there were many, many pages where practically all of the written material had been whited out. There might be a heading on the paper, a few words here, a few words there, and a few words here, none which there was not enough for it to be coherent. They blotted out the names of individuals, and it was something like the kind of situation where somebody might peek in keyholes or bathrooms and things like that, bedrooms. They accepted rumor, unsubstantiated comments from all kind of people. And the file to me indicated that a great waste of taxpayers' money is occurring through this surveillance by the FBI.
We have learned that Chambers was high up on the list of people to be dealt with in Omaha. That list, however, included others who were considered a threat as well. Among those near the top of that list were David Rice and Edward Poindexter.
In the mid-1970s, and after the death of J. Edgar Hoover, Congress took steps to monitor the CIA and the FBI to make sure the illegality of COINTELPRO would never happen again. Congress would also make sure that no one man would ever have the power that Hoover had, a power that was virtually uncontrollable. It's not known how many people in this country are still suffering and still behind bars because of COINTELPRO. Local federal court records reflect that on July 20th, 1970, the local office of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms applied for and obtained a warrant to search 3508 North 24th Street, known as headquarters for the NCCF. ATF sought this search warrant acting on a tip from a woman who claimed that she had seen weapons in the house. The informant said that she had a sister who was a member of the Black Panther Party. She said her sister was also a girlfriend of Ed Poindexter's. She said it was for those reasons that she had been going to NCCF headquarters for about 4 or 5 months. She went on to say that in recent weeks, she had seen 10 boxes that she said contained machine guns. There was also dynamite in the house. The informant said there were about 15 bundles that had about 12 sticks to the bundle. The woman also claimed that she was on the premises when a bomb was being made. She described a bomb similar to the one used at 2867 Ohio the night Menard was killed. She also gave the names of 5 different people who worked on the bomb. At no time did she mention that Rice or Poindexter were involved in making this bomb or that they were even on the premises at the time. She said that she saw 2 men involved in making the bomb, put it in the trunk of a car, and allegedly take it to where it was to be planted. The informant said that she had even seen a diagram of a room where this bomb was supposed to be placed. ATF officials knew that it was around that time that there was an explosion on the north side and dynamite was suspected. The explosion was in the room of Component Concept Corporation, located at 3815 North 24th Street. Based on this and other information, the United States Magistrate, Richard Peck, ordered the U.S. Marshal, his deputies, and a member of ATF to search the house known as NCCF headquarters. The order was granted, as we said, on July 20th, 1970. However, on July 31st, 1970, this search warrant that was applied for and granted 11 days earlier was returned to the court unserved. It is not known what happened in that 11-day period or what caused these officials to change their mind. Officer Menard was killed on August 17th, 1970, almost a month after this search warrant was granted. Could that dynamite, allegedly located at NCCF headquarters, be the same that was used in the Menard slaying? Because this warrant was never served, we will never know. During the 1971 trial, ATF was also involved in the gathering of evidence that would eventually help convict Rice and Poindexter. When both men were arrested, their clothes were confiscated by an ATF official. The clothing was sent to Washington, D.C. for chemical testing. One D.C. chemist testified at the trial that the results, in his opinion, were positive. He said that a particle of what could be ammonia dynamite was found in the front shirt pocket of David Rice. There were also several particles that could be ammonia dynamite found in the clothing of Ed Poindexter. On cross-examination, the defense showed that the particles that were found in the clothing of Rice and Poindexter did not have to be tracings of dynamite. We have learned that though ATF tested Rice and Poindexter, several other people were also tested and found positive. Among them were people mentioned by the informant in the ATF search warrant mentioned earlier. In fact, ATF and the FBI filed charges against many of those tested. What is strange, though, is that after Rice and Poindexter were convicted, the charges against the others tested were dropped by both agencies. One other note about the dynamite particle. Although a particle was found in David Rice's shirt pocket, it was the only one found in his clothes or on his skin. And in the process that's used, the dynamite particle is destroyed by the process itself, thus destroying evidence against David Rice. We have also learned that this testing procedure was relatively new in the early 1970s. Since that time, it's been learned that you can conduct the same kinds of tests on items around the home, such as some laundry detergents and a book of matches, and come up with the same positive results.
As much as you may know about stuff intellectually, you never know about it in your guts until it really happens to you. And when it happens, it's like the thing about when they come in the morning. You can run around and give speeches all day about how the COINTELPRO does this and how the CIA does that, or how the police does this, and whatever. And you believe what you're saying. You know, you have the facts and the statistics and so forth to back you up. But when it happens to you, then there's a kind of mystery and so forth. It scared me half to death. Not because of a thing of threatening my life, just not knowing and realizing that that had happened, you know, to me.
It appears that, at least in talking to some people and in earlier conversations with you, mm-hmm. that at least in your and other people who are concerned about Rice and Poindexter are concerned, there seems to be a conspiracy of tremendous magnitude.
I began to think, you know, is this a massive conspiracy? Are they that smart that they could conspire? Well, either once you start a conspiracy theory, every piece of evidence fits in. That's the nice thing about a conspiracy thing. And they say, the head of the French police at one time, like the secret police, the Sûreté, they said, the head of it used to kneel down at night and say, God, if there's not a conspiracy, let me manufacture one from which I can save the state. So, conspiracy, you know, maybe. I call it the klutz theory, that these things happen because there are people who are either shoddy in their work or poorly motivated or badly motivated or malicious, and that in combination, what might look like from one side as a conspiracy is just a lot of klutzing around by the government. That's why I don't really lose hope, because if you work harder than they do, a lot of times they go home at 5. And if you're willing to work, you can beat them.
Like at this time, then a new trial. That's been the cry of the defense since Federal Judge Erbaum's decision in 1974 to the present. It is the defense's position that if a new jury is allowed to look at the evidence they now have, and that they feel still exists in federal records, that Rice and Poindexter will get the just decision they feel they should have had 12 years ago. Key to a new trial, however, is to once again bring forth Duane Peake to testify.
It is incumbent upon the state to come forward and to rebut the evidence. And what the state did simply was they didn't cross-examine David Herzog when he testified that he had not been given that tape and that that wasn't the voice of Duane Peake. They rested their case without producing any witnesses on their own on their part of the case. I would think that at least they should bring back Duane Peake and explain that letter, explain why they didn't introduce the taker of the call, the tape itself, explain why they didn't give it to the defense. What I'm saying is that I think at this stage of the proceeding, the ball is clearly in the state's court, and they've not only fumbled it, they put it down and refused to play the game, saying that it was incumbent upon us to prove. I think that that's entirely wrong, that when there's evidence produced, the kind and quality of the evidence that we have produced thus far, that the state has something to say and should be required in a court of law to do that. And if they don't, I think a new trial should be granted. And then the state, their theory is, will read the transcript. It's not necessary to have Duane back. Oh, no. No, no.
The letter that was written to his, I guess you would call it, stepmother or whatever, the evidence that was seized in the FBI memo and so forth, with all of that information and various other information that has come to light, is it possible and would you even say probable to win a case without Duane Peake?
It's always possible. It certainly wasn't enough for Judge Hickman.
Robert Bartle is a Lincoln attorney. He's been at Poindexter's representative for a little over a year.
It's always possible, otherwise we wouldn't continue. It certainly would be much more helpful to either visit with Mr. Peake or anyone who knows firsthand the circumstances that led to his testimony and his changes of testimony in the early 70s that were the single, certainly most important factor that led to the conviction of Ed Poindexter and David Rice.
Duane Peake is the key to a certain extent to this whole case, mm-hmm. and the retrying of it all over again. How do you feel towards Duane right now?
How do I feel towards Duane? Well, years ago I was very bitter, you know, not necessarily toward him, but just toward the whole, you know, system, you know, the whole process that got me involved in this world of trouble that I'm in now, and I've been in for the past 12 years almost. And I was very bitter toward him and, you know, and the system, you know. But it's difficult to live with bitterness, man, because, you know, it eventually consumed me, you know. And I went through a couple of very difficult years of adjustment when I first came into prison in 1970, 71, April. And, you know, I got over that. A couple years I got over that and I said to myself, well, man, I'm in a, you know, a difficult situation. I'm going to have to make the best of it and try to get out of the situation what I can that'll help me, you know. And so I had to let go of that bitterness. You know, I had to just turn it loose. And I don't hold any ill feelings toward Duane. Probably the strongest feeling that I have concerning Duane personally is one of intrigue, you know, mystery, you know. What, you know, what's going on, you know? What happened, you know? Who else was involved, you know? Come forward and tell the truth. But, you know, where is he?
What Duane did is more of an act of a Judas than is the act of a snitch. Because a snitch simply tells what he knows, maybe for pay, maybe for other reasons. But what Duane did was to follow a script. This is what you're supposed to say, Duane. In the whole process, from the time he was arrested to the time of the trials, he gave 6 or 7 statements under oath, including his testimony at the preliminary hearing and the trial and so forth. No two of them are the same. It's very clear what happened, and when I say script, how clearly accurate that is. But anyway, the thing is, Duane was 15 years old at the time he was arrested, 16 years old at the time of the trial, and at 15 years old or 16 years old, if I were in his shoes, and I was told, you will either testify this way or you will die in the electric chair, I would make up something on my mother, and I love my mother. And so there is no way in the world that I would hold a grudge against somebody who was a child. You know, what he did was the act of a Judas, but here, it was survival.
Throughout the preparation of this program, we've tried to talk to people in the county attorney's office and the Omaha Police Division who have been directly involved in the Rice Poindexter case over these past 12 years. Their response has been no comment. The reason, the case is still in court. As far as those who were directly involved from the FBI or alcohol, tobacco, and firearms, many of them are either no longer with those agencies or no longer here in Omaha. We have also learned that as recently as 2 weeks ago, Amnesty International has gotten involved in the Rice Poindexter case. Amnesty International is a multiracial, multinational group that's dedicated to the freedom of political prisoners all over the world. They have recently sent a cash contribution to the Rice Poindexter Legal Defense Fund here in Omaha and have written as many as 15 publications around the country expressing their concern about the possible wrongful incarceration of Rice and Poindexter. They have not come out and called them political prisoners as yet, but they do express a great deal of concern and are investigating. As far as an ending for this program, there really is none. For David Rice and Edward Poindexter, the roller coaster ride continues.
According to the rules, I'm on top right now, as far as this case is concerned. But poor people and non-white people in this country generally know that the rules are used when the people who make the rules want to use them. So if they go by the rules, yes, I'm in good shape, and I would have reason to be optimistic. But they haven't gone through the rules so far. So how can, you know, and it's been like a roller coaster ride.
I'm optimistic because I know that eventually, man, truth is going to come out, you know, eventually. You know, that's just a law of nature, you see. And I understand that, you know, it's going to be a an extremely difficult journey, you know. It has been, and I'm prepared for it, you know. But whatever happens, man, you know, I'm going to be okay, you know. I insist on that, see. But I think that, you know, as the political climate in this country goes, shifts from one extreme to the other, back and forth, hopefully we'll get caught right when it makes a swing to the left or in the center or something, you know, and be the timing be just right.
I want to believe that that the goods outnumber the bads, or that the apt outnumber the inept.